design, and not that if the architect does a design, hands it over, and a building services engineer sticks up pipes and ducts in it where they can squeeze them in and begs the architect for more space to fit them in, or the engineer tries to prop the building up some way to stop it falling over. We really see it as an integrated process, and really see that BIM helps in that process. Thermal continuity, so just make sure that insulation joins up everywhere, doesn't have gaps in it, doesn't have things getting in the way of it. And then the heat loss envelope is really just the areas of the building that lose heat. Because in the UK, the biggest source of energy use in a building is really the heating, or in an office or teaching building like this, it's probably the cooling in the summer months and the heating in the winter months. So it's really that part of the building envelope that matters. So design coordination. This is a plant room that's designed when we're in the BIM process with the architectural model and the services, building services model put together, just linked in. So there's still two models, but linking them together so we can see them in one. Making design decisions to move some of the plant outside the building because it makes more sense there, there's more space there. That's the decision you can make intelligently when you can see this in 3D and see what the implications are. And then to illustrate that kind of real world scenario, this is a plant room, unfortunately, one of our buildings, designed without the engineer, the building services engineer involved in BIM. You can't really see it, but there's actually a person standing there, trying to get in to access and kind of do some maintenance in there. Quite difficult. Whereas this is one that's the one that was on the previous image where it's fully coordinated, there's a wall space. You know, building services engineers, you know, all credit to them, they do their job in design, but they're not particularly great at visualising three dimensions of where their services go, we often find. And I hope I'm not insulting anyone.
No, my job was to coordinate moments.
I'm sure you regret that then. So doing this kind of stuff, really fantastic benefit, really good from design, client satisfaction, getting the construction on site, all good. Thermal continuity, get a 3D model of a building, particularly complex building, which we took on at stage E, so designed by some other architects prior to our involvement. This is a model sliced up as it is in the Revit software, and then filtered to say anything that's insulation, colour red, so I can see it straight away, really easy. And then the circles I've put on outside of Revit, I've just done them in graphics editing on the image afterwards to highlight them. But you can see straight away where you get a gap in the insulation. That's quite immediately in your face and obvious. Whereas if you're trying to do this on two-dimensional drawings, you're thinking in your head, where do I need to do a drawing to check where there might be an issue? And if I haven't got that drawing, is it really worth my time asking someone making a drawing so I can actually just check that? If you've got a model, fine, do it everywhere. Put the section in, you can move the section through the building, and it's updating as you're moving the section. And you can see straight away, and you know, okay, well, I freeze there, that's a problem, we need to deal with it. Now, something like Revit, and pretty much all BIM software, won't let you actually do anything about the analysis of that issue. Re-detail it, remodel it. But at that point, we take it out and we use proper thermal modelling software to actually check what the heat loss is there. So you can see this is inside the space, this is the parapet, so the roof's up here. You see 20 degrees inside, whatever it is outside. This is the cold spot going up in the concrete. Even though there's a thermal break in there, that's still a form of thermal bridge. Now, like you asked before, why do we choose Revit? ArchiCAD now seems to be advancing on this stuff far more than something like Revit is, and you can do this kind of modelling in ArchiCAD now. So if you've modelled your building in ArchiCAD, you can assign the right materials to it, and it will give you this kind of information with the visual and with the contour lines of temperatures on that. It's been validated against some energy modelling, I think, but I'm not sure if it's validated yet for Passivhaus, but it's certainly going a long way in that direction so that architects can think about these things and appreciate and understand what's going on the details they design. Now, the other side of this, of course, is, as I said before, sexy graphics don't cut it. So you can do this and it can all look very well, but actually it's still the numbers that matter in this. It still needs the analysis that comes out of it. So heat loss envelope, from a visual point of view, this is the same project. So the other section was kind of cut through this building. This is three buildings around one site. It's intensely complicated building geometrically. There's a lot of things cantilevered above ground, zigzags, you know, everything's going on in this building. Even the building, which looks more or less rectilinear and orthogonal, it's got kind of things all stepping and turning, all sorts of stuff going on. Now, to just visually check what the building envelope is of that, to know what all the external surfaces of that are, is pretty difficult. when you model it and you stick all this on there, you can turn that around, you can look at it from underneath, you can look from above, you can go through all that stuff, you can check all this stuff, and you can just get a much better understanding and appreciation of where everything is. And it's not necessarily so much that as an architect I want to look at all that kind of stuff particularly, but I want to be able to communicate that to the other people I'm collaborating with and working with and who are going to build it, so they can appreciate that all these surface areas all matter. They're all part of the equation of this building's performance. So, data, getting numbers out of it. There's a few things that we focused on. One was treated floor area, so that's effectively the floor area of the building that gets heated. You know, treated means it's conditioned, or, you know, not air conditioned, but, you know, whether it's got heating in the room. So, you know, store cupboard with no heating, that's not treated floor area. Stairway, not heated, that's not treated floor area. So, treated floor areas, because that's what gets measured against heating energy. Actual volumes, because you need to know that for your air tightness of the building. Ventilation volumes, because you need to calculate accurately how much air supply you're providing for people in the building. Heat loss areas, so what I was just talking about in terms of those surface areas, and then window and door opening areas, which is, you know, very straightforward, out of the box kind of BIM stuff, which everyone should be doing if they're doing BIM. So the areas and volumes, as I said earlier, a room in a BIM process is actually an object in itself. So you drop a room into a space, it finds the edges of the room, it finds the top and the bottom of the room, so it knows what the volume and the space of that room is. It's not hugely sophisticated, so if you do really complicated things it won't get off of that, you have to kind of figure out how to do that yourself. But so what we do is we set up our template so it has some filters in it, so you can model away, look at the plan, and it's already started to colour up to show you which bits are in the treated floor area, which bits are not. And some things have got different factors. So, you know, we have our schedule, has the rooms, where the room is, what the actual area of that room is, what the volume is, which the software is just calculating for us, the category of space that is in terms of energy, and then what that category area works out to be. So there's a factor. So sometimes it's exactly what the room area is. Sometimes it's nothing, because like I said, if the room's not heated, you don't want to know the area of that room. And sometimes it's a proportion if there's something else going on in the room. And then there's event volume, which is essentially, again, just a calculation built in there. So that if we update the room sizes by moving the model around, the vent volume will just update, because it's just got a calculation. It's just factoring in that the ventilation air in a room that's used by people occupying it is the bottom 2.5 meters kind of thing. So we don't need the whole volume, we just need that amount of air to know that's what we're providing for the space for ventilation. So some of this stuff is just built into the software. Any three-dimensional, any BIM software will do all this kind of stuff. Some of it we've built into our template by just adding a few calculations into the schedules, a few extra parameters into the project, so that into the template so they show up in the project. Nothing particularly complicated. Heat loss areas, so as I showed with the kind of colourful one before, every one of these surface areas counts for heat loss. So you think the more surface area you've got, the greater your heat loss is going to be, the more inefficient your building is going to be. And so think of that as a kind of analogy as to what that really means, is you think that if you're really cold, people get really cold, then they tend to kind of huddle up, keep their limbs in, and that's kind of reducing your surface area, because that's the area that you lose heat from your body from. And buildings are the same. If you cantilever something out or stick something out very long and thin, then that's going to have a lot of surface area, it's going to lose a lot of the heat. Or in a hot environment, lose a lot of the cool from inside. So again, these things, once they're modelled, they're all there. So they're actual numbers, we can take them out, schedule them out accurately, live. This kind of stuff, otherwise, is done by a Passivhaus consultant sitting there with a bunch of PDFs and measuring them 1.1. I've got to say, I really don't envy anyone having to do that. And this is a much more sane way of doing this kind of process of generating accurate kind of areas for these things. And then opening areas, so sizes of windows and doors, this kind of stuff is absolutely BIM 101. Anyone doing BIM is changing windows and doors, I would hope. And that's got, you know, accurate sizes, all that kind of stuff in it. So it's not difficult, it's part of the process. And in terms of what comes out of this, so what are we actually delivering? So first Passivhaus project we did three simultaneously actually, but the first one that we got data out of was nearly 2,500 square meter school. And two form entry primary school. And that's got two boilers in it. It's got two boilers because the engineers and the clients were concerned that if one boiler broke down, they wanted to make sure the other one would still be there to switch on. But on the next building, after these ones, we had another check, we said, okay, we'll go with one boiler this time, because A, the boiler's the same size as a domestic boiler, more or less. So they can just call up your local plumber, say, the boiler's gone down, can you fix it for us? There's nothing specialist involved there. There's no big delay, there's no problem. The risk is minimal. The other thing is, if the boiler breaks down, they've actually got weeks before the building starts to cool down, because the building is that well performing that it just doesn't matter. On this particular project, somebody switched off the boilers in the middle of winter. We never worked out why, I don't know if it's deliberate or not, but they just didn't notice for several weeks. And then the caretaker was doing some rounds to check, so, the boiler's not on this, we better switch them back on again, it's winter, isn't it? But nobody noticed. It was, because the building is so well performing, because it's ventilated, so it's not getting stuffy, it's getting plenty of fresh air. So, brilliant. 90% reduction in gas consumption. This is compared to the building they were in previously. Now, I did get queried on this a couple of times, which is a fair point. They were in an old building before, and they moved to a brand new building, so you'd hope it consumed less energy anyway. But the other school, which we delivered at the same time, has just recently had a head teacher move from another brand new school to that one. And so she has been in a brand new primary school, comparable size, moved to a Passivhaus primary school that we delivered through this whole BIM Passivhaus process. In her old school, she had her energy bills, she's familiar with that. She came here, first governor's meeting, sat down, looked through it all, said, where's the energy bills? I said, no, that's it there. Are you sure? Yeah, that's really the energy bill. Because the energy bill on the new building was $5,000, and she was used to $45,000 energy bills on the previous one. So this is real comparison between new buildings, not between old and new. And just in terms of what that really means, as a colleague of mine, and these are the boilers in that school. It's, it really is not a great big room full of, steaming kind of engines working away. It's just a couple of boilers like you've got at home. They're a bit bigger than what you've got at home, I would hope. You shouldn't need one that big at home, but they're similar kind of scale. The other thing is that natural ventilation was what we always did as a sustainable architecture practice. We were committed, it was just like, don't touch air handling units, don't touch mechanical ventilation, all that kind of thing. But when we started looking at the way things worked, and when we started looking at Passivhaus, we realised that it actually wasn't performing. Because natural ventilation, as we like to term it, is really kind of manual ventilation mostly. It's dependent on people opening windows manually, or sometimes building natural system opening and closing window. But people always manually interact with that to override it. And there's always reasons windows don't get opened enough, because it's too windy, or it's too cold, or too bright, or there's endless lists. And in a classroom, in a school, you can imagine wind blows papers everywhere, windows get shut. And the other thing is that if you design to building regs and you crack a window open like this, or there's some trickle vents, in reality it just won't deliver the right level of ventilation for the oxygen levels that are needed in the space inside. And this is the state that the industry is in at the moment, and there's a lot of debate about this, because of course there's a huge portion of the industry totally committed to natural ventilation as they see it, because as we were before, we thought it was the solution to use the least energy to provide the best environment. But actually we found that by introducing mechanical ventilation with heat recovery, so this is not air conditioning, this is just simply an air handling unit with a fan which works very slowly, drawing air, fresh air from outside in, and then delivering it to the spaces where people are in. In our schools it runs in the winter months only, not in the summer. In summer it works on manual window ventilation and a bit of building management system. But with the heat recovery, so in winter it's pulling in the air from outside, 5 degrees or less than 5 degrees, it comes in. It uses the heat from the internal air to transfer it across. So there's no air mixing, there's no contamination of the air, just the energy. And then the air carries on and then it's warm. So it comes into the classroom 18 degrees or something like that. So it's comfortable. You don't get any cold drafts, you don't get any breeze, you don't get any gusts of wind coming in or anything. And some people that are using Passivhaus buildings are now using it all year round, because it's just providing that much better quality of indoor air. And that then means you've got a constant supply of fresh, filtered air into the room, the oxygen levels are good, and the carbon dioxide is being extracted also, because you're also taking the air out of the space through the same method. Now the blue line on here is natural ventilation monitored in a school, and you can see that kids come in the morning, CO2 levels go up, red line 15 parts per million, that's the recommended level of CO2 for a classroom, and just before you get break time, kids have been in there for a couple of hours, getting pretty high. Just before lunchtime, morning break time, it's getting really high, because there's been no kind of purge ventilation, there's been no proper ventilation in the classroom. It's getting pretty stuffy in there. So by early afternoon, this is the time when we all start falling asleep. We start feeling a bit drowsy. And it's not just because teachers teach boring stuff in the afternoon. This is because typically the oxygen levels in the room are quite low, carbon dioxide levels quite high, and it's just not very comfortable, and it's hard for the brain to stay focused and to stay alert. So the green is the line of CO2 levels when we're using mechanical ventilation with the heat recovery on. So CO2 levels still go up a bit, but then they drop when you have a break. That's because you've got nobody in the room, so there's nobody consuming the oxygen, nobody putting CO2 in the room. So it carries on through the day like that. So this is, from our point of view, is like we overcame our mindset that natural ventilation was the only way to do it and actually achieve something much better. And the other side of this, that people don't seem to always appreciate, is that this actually uses less energy than if you do it with natural ventilation. Because if you do it with manually open windows, people open the window, you get cold air coming in, the heating's going to work that much harder to warm the space up again. We talk about winter heating bugs mostly. When you're doing this, you're not having that situation at all, so you're not losing that heat. So the energy required to run a couple of fans going at fairly low speed is just so much less than the energy required to continually top that heating up. It's kind of slightly counterintuitive when you first come across it, but it works really well. So, very happy clients. Clients that knew nothing about Passivhaus, knew nothing about BIM, very pleased with their buildings, very excited about the sense of space inside the building and what it does in terms of their learning, in terms of their pupils, in terms of teachers that have previously suffered quite badly from asthma, reporting that actually their time at school is much better now, they're taking less sick days, they're less dependent on using inhalers. So, you know, I'm a bit cautious about saying that kind of stuff because it's not some kind of long-term study that verifies it, shows absolutely, but this is the kind of anecdotal stuff we're getting back from clients. So this is one of the first schools. This is Bushby Primary School in Bushby Hills Primary School in Wolverhampton. Showing the kind of design that we're doing with that also. And then Okamino Primary School, which is also one of the other Passivhaus ones delivered early on. This is the slightly larger one, the one that I showed the boilers for. And then this is Wilkinson Primary School, so this is some of the space inside the building. So this is another primary school, also Passivhaus, just finished end of last year, so in their first term or two terms now. And also, you can see it's sort of similar materials to what I've shown with the earlier stuff, so you know, not compromising our choice of design, materials, sustainability, all that kind of side of things by any of these processes. Chester Belmore, this is due for completion very soon. This is in Camden. This is the one, very complicated one I showed you with the heat loss kind of areas, all those calculations earlier on. This was designed by Rick Leather Architects, and then we were on the Wilmot Dixon contractors delivery team to detail it for Passivhaus and all the kind of architectural delivery side. Hereford Archive, so this is being applied to all kinds of building types, not just schools, not just houses. This is the box at the back, which is clad in cedar shingles, is the repository, so that's a big concrete structure inside, very heavy mass, very highly insulated, above ground, not insulated to the ground, so it keeps close temperature with the ground, very, very stable humidity and temperature in there, because it's lots of paper records that need to be kept at very stable conditions. And then the front of it is essentially office and public space, so library and access, and you know, if you want to go and see your birth certificate or whatever, you can go there and access that kind of stuff. And then this is the last project I was going to show you, is just a quick one, which is the University of East Anglia, which Jenny was involved in a little bit before she came here to university, with their ADAPT Centre. So this is teaching spaces, lecture theatre, incubator spaces for small businesses, startups, enterprises. And it's been labelled UK's greenest building. When it's finished, we'll wait to see if that's really the case or not. But it's been labelled that because it's Passivhaus. It's also BREEAM Outstanding, or it's on track to achieve BREEAM Outstanding and Passivhaus. It's also using a lot of very, very low carbon materials. It's aimed to be a carbon sink rather than a carbon use. In terms of embodied carbon, so it's got a lot of timber. You know, timber trees absorb carbon dioxide during the lifetime. Using a building, carbon dioxide is locked in rather than emitted. If you build a building out of concrete or cement, you're emitting CO2 through the whole process. And then the exterior you can see here is actually clad in prefabricated thatch panels. So re-instigating kind of thatching industry in East Anglia and getting them to thatch traditionally, but into modern ply panels, which are then clipped up onto this kind of framing system on the outside. So traditional materials, because the university is one of the one of the centres for research for climate change in the world. If you remember Climate Gate, when somebody's emails got hacked and all that kind of stuff, these guys got their emails spread around the internet. So they wanted us to use all their data and research for climate change. So they wanted us to use local materials that had low carbon. They wanted us to make sure that it was modelled for a 100-year lifespan to check the whole life costing and whole life carbon. So what kind of mechanical equipment goes into it, how often it needs changing. Is this equipment now going to be the right equipment in 50 years or 100 years' time, or is it actually going to be more sensible to use a different kind of equipment so that it's going to be better in the long term? Which is a really exciting project to work on, that kind of stuff. It's not often a client has a 100-year kind of vision for their building's performance, which is great. And lots of very careful modelling on the kind of BIM side as well, to kind of look at shading. Is it better to make shading longer, or is it better to make it higher, or is it better to make it deeper, closer to the window or further away, these kind of things, and then checking. Today might be one scenario, but 80 years down the time, what's it like then? Is it still going to be valid? Or if it's not, how are we going to adapt it? Or is there a way to do it differently? So really interesting. And then I thought I'd just leave you with this quote, just to kind of wrap it all up, is that George Bloch's inventor or physicist, I'm not sure actually, but his quote, essentially all models are wrong, but some are useful, is that there's quite a lot of talk about BIM having one model as the one source of truth and all this kind of stuff. And, an architect, stereotyping architects other than ourselves, of course, quite often build three-dimensional models because they look good for visualization or something, but don't necessarily represent what's going to be built. And it's important to remember that actually the model is there for a purpose, and that the model should be useful for that purpose, not for something else. And so for us, as I've shared with that last section there, is that we're modeling and making sure that's useful for making sure energy and comfort for the passive standard all comes together and all works. So we do lots of pretty visualization, we do all that kind of stuff as well, but we're making sure that what we're doing is useful. And the same with the PHPP as a kind of energy model, is it's clear about what things, what information needs to go in that model to make it a useful model, not one that's a show and tell, but doesn't actually get you anywhere. And I think this is something that some of the other software packages out there have not quite, or maybe some of the users of software packages have not quite grasped in a sense. And it's easy to get seduced by something that gives you a lovely graphical representation of heat, energy consumption or heat loss or something like that, without really knowing if it's accurate enough to be actually useful. Or the reverse, modeling to the nth degree, so something is just too detailed, doesn't serve any purpose, wastes all the time. So not so useful. And that's our website if you want to look up any more about us particularly, and that's our offices in Hereford. So if you've got any more questions there, happy to chat for a bit longer, and hopefully that's been useful, valuable for everybody in the room to learn something about BIM from our particular perspective and how we've adopted it and used it for us.
Just a quick thank you. Got questions?
Missed the questions, honestly. It's not on purpose.
Can you tell us a little bit more about the school in Camden and the relationship that you then had with the architect and what you did with the information then supplied you with?
It was housing in Camden, and that was housing, and they drew it 2D, so we got 2D drawings from them and we modeled it. So the relation was they worked with clients and they checked drawings and we submitted back to them. They looked at our model a couple of times, I think. But otherwise, that was it.
So essentially what was built was what you modelled?
Yeah. I mean, they did planning drawings and then they did some more detailed drawings of planning, but not a lot more. And it was a bit of a headache sometimes. So I took your drawing and now we're going to try and achieve Passivhaus, which is quite challenging. And they had been briefed on Passivhaus, but not early enough to really get it to that level of detail.
You mentioned about the Passivhaus and BIM as well at the same time.
Yeah.
What do you think in terms of the supplier chain as well, in terms of the Passivhaus side of things? Because I guess, for example, the windows and some of the services, they need to be certified in Passivhaus and Institute. How easy it is to implement the information into BIM as well?
At the moment, it's not really a critical issue because we're only taking the kind of level of information I've shared there from the model into the PHPT. So we're not taking, for example, the energy efficiency factors of the ventilation unit from Revit out to PHPT. So we don't need a model from the manufacturer, from the supply chain for that. In the long term, it would be good to be able to have that so that we could have it there to keep an eye on that kind of stuff. Things like windows, it's a little bit extra work for us because most window manufacturers just run in CAD files, so we would tend to take their CAD files and then we would model it ourselves, make our own window components to work on the BIM side of things. So it's a bit more work, but on the other hand, some might say that if we got it directly from them, we'd want a QA to make sure it does what we want to do anyway, so it's kind of, you know, swings and roundabouts to a certain degree. And in terms of the data, I think the industry and the supply chain is still very immature in terms of providing useful data in BIM components. So there's the National BIM Library from the NBS, and there's bimstore.co.uk, and there's a few other suppliers out there that provide manufacturers' content. And they've got a certain amount of data embedded in them, which, like the NBL, National BIM Library stuff, has got data which works for government-required outputs and things like that, which is, you know, it's quite useful, but again, kind of questions over whether if we use this stuff, do we need to QA it to make sure it works the way we'd want to use it and things like that anyway, or is it better just to do it ourselves and do it way right the first time? So I think it's a really interesting area of development to see going forward as to how the supply chain matures.
And how do you find the collaboration aspect as well in terms of working with other sort of professional like the quantity surveyor?
It's getting much better. So at the moment, structural engineers are not surprised if we ask them for BIM. Building services engineers, probably half still surprised and not quite sure what we're talking about, or panic slightly. The other half, pretty much okay. Quantity surveyors, only a few have started really recently. There's a lot in the industry talking about it now, which is good. And there's certainly more and more that have got tools to measure off of the digital model, which is great. So that's starting to happen more. So again, QS is probably a bit less than 50% pro, but some of them still, I don't want to do that yet. I've got my ways and means of measuring, don't make me do another one. And I guess the other thing, which is, you know, I don't know from a QS point of view how it is from at your level, but from a lot of, QS has been in the industry a long time. They have their rules of thumb. They have built up their kind of methodologies in their office about how they develop cost plans, working with the rules of measurement that they use, and they're quite wed to that, and they're a little bit reluctant to A, be open about that as one side of it, but B, change to a more collaborative, more open way of establishing these. Because, you know, the advantage you can see with this is we could develop the model at any stage and have the QS feeding directly off the model as it's going, giving us live kind of cost information, so we can know if we do something a bit more complex, actually it's adding cost into the build. Yeah, we know that anyway, but not all architects appreciate that, I think. But it's not any QS that we've talked to yet, even ones we're working with that are doing BIM, that are quite willing to provide such a proactive kind of live role. They're a bit more cautious about sitting back and saying, yes, we'll take your model, we'll measure from the model, but we'll give you our report. We won't kind of have an interactive, up-to-date kind of process. I think it's pushing that direction, I think, you know, potentially in the future.
I just have one more appreciation.